Mr. Ravenscroft, you told us here about this new experience of using the behavioral science applied to public policy. Why this change was adopted? Why was a sign that something like this was necessary?
Well, I guess it's not so new. Not so new in the UK. It started in 2010. But in 2010, there was a particular moment in UK government history. So we had a new coalition government, and new governments are looking for new ideas. But it was also a time of deep austerity. So new government was looking for new ideas, but possibly low-cost ideas. So it was a good time to bring in new approaches. But there was also a mass of research building from behavioral science, studies like social psychology, behavioral economics. And the idea was, well, if there's all this research going on, can we adopt it into policy to make it better?
Did it work in the practice? What did you really begin to exercise with this science?
Well, in practical terms, it started with a particular policy challenge around tax in the UK. So in austerity, it's obviously a good idea to bring in extra money. And so the policy challenge was sort of, how can you encourage people to pay their taxes on time and bring that money in from the government? And we tried a series of things over the course of 12 months. But just to give you one example, there, if you haven't paid your tax on time, you would be sent a letter. You sent a letter from the government saying, you haven't paid your tax on time, why don't you pay? And we introduced one single line into that letter saying, look, 9 out of 10 people pay their tax on time. Read, you are one of the minority that don't pay your tax on time. And just the insertion of that letter led to a significant increase in the number of people that are paying their tax on time. Now, not overhauling it, but you're sort of going from about a third of people paying their tax on time and adding another kind of 1.5 percentage points on top of that. And that's just from inserting one line. And that gave us the kind of reputation, some sort of credibility to test more and more in that policy area and now much wider in the UK.
It's about incentives. It's about how can you explain what can make this difference? You said it, even small things can do this kind of thing. You said some letters in the phrase in this letter. What kind of experience, other experience, small changes that can make, if not big, but some difference?
Sure. Yeah, you're right. It's about incentives, but crucially, it's about things that incentivize us, things that motivate us, that are not simply, is it legal or illegal? Is it going to financially benefit me? Have I read or can I read somewhere? It's all the other things that motivate your behavior. So the example with the tax letters, it's about the social influence. We care about what other people are doing. To give you another example, we've worked on, a while ago, unemployment. And there the idea was, how do you get people to change their job search activities to get them a job faster? And here we looked at a couple of things with inside job centers. One was make it more simple, how many forms they have to sign up when they come in. And the second was thinking about how you plan your week or how you plan your job search activities. So we asked people to work through step by step and make a commitment to, next week I'm going to go to 3 interviews. Okay, what days are you going to go to the interviews? Oh, Monday, Tuesday. Have you arranged those interviews? Have you confirmed them? So walking through the specific steps, what psychologists call kind of implementation intentions, that acts as a kind of commitment to actually go on and doing it. And indeed, in that example, we do find that, again, that significantly increases the number of people that find work within 3 months.
You also said that this kind of experience now is beginning to spread to other countries. You already have some experience in some countries. Can you talk about, a little about this and how can this knowledge can be applied somewhere else?
Sure. Yeah, we're very much not the only people doing it in the world. And also our organization since 2014 has become a public-private mutual and allowed us to work with other international governments. So we're now working in around 20 countries around the world. To give you one example, we worked on a trial in Mexico. And this was all to do with how do you encourage businesses to actually formalize? So you've got a lot of people that are in the gray economy. How do you get these businesses to sort of join? And there was already a large government program where businesses had signed up to do that. But the problem was they weren't actually declaring their revenues. They weren't actually formalizing. And we conducted a trial with around 750,000 businesses. testing different messages sent to them by SMS, and indeed kind of the most effective there led to a 37% increase in number of people declaring to the number of people who actually are in practice formalizing, because it's not formalizing until you sort of provide that data to the state. But yeah, so that's one example. We're working on others. There's also big organizations like the World Bank, who are setting up their own team, other nation governments. So hopefully it's just the start of a very exciting movement.